technique. Don't sweat the technique. Let's trace the hits and check the file. Let's see who bit the dot, tech the style. I flip the script so it can't get filed. At least not now, it'll take a while. I change the pace to complete the beat. I drop the bass to MCs get weak. For every word they trace is a scar they keep. It's when I speak, they freak to sweat the technique.
Hello, good evening, and welcome to the Guildhall in Southampton for week 5 of the partypoker.com snooker Premier League
live on Sky Sports.
Two matches for you tonight. They line up like this. Ex-Aussie champion Stuart Bingham faces two-time UK champion Ding Junhui, and current UK champ Judd Trump faces the 2002 world champion Peter Ebdon. Hello, good to see you again. Two more wonderful matches tonight as we enter the halfway stage of this season's competition. Only 4 group matches to book your place in finals weekend. And as we saw last week, even previous winners are struggling to get there.
This is a match between a world champion of 10 years ago and a player who may well be world champion sometime in the next 10 years. Frame tension chance for Ebdon. A scrappy opening frame.
Well done. That was excellent. Very instinctive player. This is an excellent break.
And he's porting off this one with another substantial contribution.
3-1 down was being outplayed. He's been as determined as anybody.
This looks like the 304th century. Ebdon's career.
Beautiful shot.
A 4-2 win for Mark Allen over Peter Ebdon. It's the world champion of 2005 against the world champion of 2010.
What about that?
Clear run to the winning line now then. He's won the open frame. To steal the frame, in it goes.
Yeah, that was the 6.
It's 1-1.
Very well compiled century break from Sean Murphy. Good stuff now.
It's Robertson level at 2-2. He's flying. Beautiful. A break of 113.
Tremendous, tremendous shot.
Five.
Oh my word, that's a horrendous kick.
With 2 points to top the table through his 4-2 win over Sean Murphy.
Yeah, defeat for Sean Murphy all but ends his quest this year for Premier League glory. Neil Robertson topping Group A. And that defeat for Ebdon still leaves him top of Group B, but as you can obviously work out yourself, a win tonight for Judd Trump will see him overtake him. I'm joined by former world number 3, Neil Folds, joins us now. Just looking back at last week's play, Sean Murphy obviously will be disappointed with his form so far in the Premier League, but just proving how difficult it is.
I think he's played all right for the most of it, you know. I think he can consider himself very unlucky. Last week, he had no luck. He had a terrible kick at an important stage. It's just not been his year. And I think he's out of it now as a consequence. It's a shame for him.
Let's talk about our matches tonight. We'll start with the second one first, if that makes sense. Judd Trump against Peter Ebdon. It's fair to call it a grudge match over the last 2 or 4 months. I think it was in July, the Australian Open. Peter beat Ding 5-4 and Judd tweeted something about the speed of Peter Ebdon, shall we say, to put it in a kind way. Are you surprised, A, that he made that comment on a social networking site, and B, will there be a grudge between them, or is it forgotten about?
And C, the fact that you would stir it up and mention it, maybe.
I wouldn't do that.
No, I think Judd's entitled to say what he thinks, and some people would agree with that about Ebdon being too slow. He's allowed to play at whatever speed he wants when he's playing in ranking tournaments. The problem is, he can't play that slowly tonight. Mm. That's the worry. A grudge match, I think they probably respect each other, but both would like to win badly, I guess. There's no slow player in this form of the game.
There isn't, indeed. We've got a 25-second shot clock, so that's when the shots have to be made, which leads you to the question, who will win tonight? The bookies really do fancy Judd 7-4, and you have to put 7 on, obviously, to win 4. 4-1 for Peter Ebdon. Last week, he was 5-2. I stood here at the top of the table and said, that's worth a bet, 2.5-1. The bookies now make it 4-1 for Peter. He has got to win 4 frames, obviously, a minimum for that bet to come off. Can you see that happening tonight?
I think everything points to a Trump victory, but you must never discount Ebdon. We've seen in the last 6 months how dangerous he is. People had written him off as a player. Never underestimate the man. He's got a great mind and a great determination. I think Trump is favourite, though. I think that's fair enough.
That's who you're going with as well?
It would have to be.
OK, let's talk about our first game on as well. It features Ding Junhui, who has never done it yet in the Premier League. Got to the final, obviously, last year against Stuart Bingham, making his debut. How do you see that one going?
I can think of some great matches Ding's played in the league when he beat Stephen Hendry, and I think Hendry potted his first ball in the 6th frame. He annihilated him 1 year. Ding was fluent in Skegness the first week, but he's playing another really fluent player. I mean, Stuart Bingham, this format will suit him, you know. He is quick around the table. He won't be affected by things. It's a very attractive match, this one.
Will he be thinking, Stuart Bingham, about his last game, his first game in the Premier League, where he led 3-0 against Sean Murphy, had the chance to make it 4, didn't? Came back to just earn a point.
Got a point out of it against an experienced player, but he's got to be disappointed with that. But it's just one match, and he loves playing. You know, he's loved watching this league on the television on Sky for years. This is his chance. I think this is a very, very good match to watch.
Okay, the bookies make this one slightly more difficult to call. Ding, obviously the favourite, but even money. Stuart Bingham, 11-5, just under threes there, 23-10. Obviously, Bingham's got some fans in tonight. Even money for the two-time UK champion. Good bet.
I think Ding would have to be favoured again. I think he might come through this game. Maybe a 3-3 draw, you know, that would be a good result again for Stuart, having played two very dangerous players so far. It could be a draw. That is one of a possible 3 results, don't forget.
OK, I'm going to let you get back to the dressing room. Clive's also on his way, but there's only one chair, so first come, first served. Right, let's get our first match underway. The players introduced, as always, by our brilliant MC, Mr. John McDonald. And first up, it's Ding Junhui.
Welcome to the Guildhall, Southampton. Matchroom Sport proudly present the PartyPoker.com Premier League snooker. Coming to you live here on Sky Sports HD. 6 frames, 25-second shot clock. Our referee in charge of the action is Brendan Moore. It's now time to meet the players. Would you please welcome China's number one. Ladies and gentlemen, the former Masters champion is Ding Junhui. Ding's opponent is Stuart Bingham.
Ladies and gentlemen, time to meet the world number 10 and the former Australian Open champion. It's Stuart Bingham!
A lot of support for you tonight, which is nice. I think, in fact, both players have got great support here. Let's just briefly look at your first game in the Premier League. 3-0 up, finished 3-0. Were you disappointed about that?
In the end, yeah, looking back at it. Obviously, 3-0 up, I was cruising, and then I had a chance, and I missed a red in the middle, and the whole sort of tide turned then, really. Sean's a good player, he is, sort of got going, and he pulled out a sort of 3-0 draw. Mm.
There are no easy games, obviously, in the Premier League. You look at Ding, hasn't won the Premier League title yet, got to the final last year, has won two UKs as well, yet to win the world title, but everyone in snooker knows that's just a matter of time. In your opinion, how good a player is he? Because I think you turned pro in 95, so you've been around the block, shall we say, in a kind way, but from all the players you've played, how good a player do you think he is?
Yeah, he's obviously very strong. He's made probably in the top four or five in the world, and obviously he's it's sort of a lot of pressure on his shoulders coming, obviously, from China. He obviously struggles in China, but he's up there with the best.
I think I'm right in saying you're here, obviously, because you won the Australian Open last year. Beat Ding on the way. So you up for it tonight?
Definitely. Sort of great crowd, sort of packed out, and I just can't wait to play.
Let's start now. Good luck. Stuart Bingham, everyone. Thanks, Stuart. Yeah, quick reminder, you can tweet me a question. I will ask the winner that question after the first game. Just send your tweet to @SkySnooker. Let's join our boys in the box. Neil Fulton first up. Clive Everton.
It's world number 10, Stuart Bingham, versus world number 11, Ding Junhui.
Thank you, the first frame.
Give or take a place or two. I don't think world rankings are perhaps quite as significant as they used to be because they change after each tournament. And I think players these days tend to think that as long as they're in the top 16, that's okay.
I'm sure you're right. I think they're more accurate now, though, for that reason. They change after every tournament, whereas it used to be once a year after the World Championships. And, of course, an out-of-form player might hold a ranking for a long time that maybe he wasn't playing up to, or better players were ranked too low. But these are the best players in the world. That was a very difficult opener. This isn't difficult, though, for Ding. What a start. How do you like these to start a break? Black goes everywhere, reds spread.
One.
In the middle of last week, Ding Junhui lost 4-0 in the final of an Asian Players Tour Championship event to Stephen Lee. These days, of course,
eight.
The players are playing in something or other every week, if they choose to.
Nine.
Yeah, I think Stuart made the point that Ding doesn't really play his best in China nowadays. There's five ranking tournaments a year over there, and rarely do we see him play at his best in the major ones. Of course, that PTC event was a good performance to get all the way through in. But he finds it hard, and he says the pressure's on him playing at home.
16.
But there's so many tournaments he could do with getting over that problem. Sure, there is pressure on him,
17.
But you know, people like Jimmy White have had to put up with all kinds of support worldwide over the years. Adoring fans and all that. One thing you know about him, he's a tremendous scorer. Very good at breaking the reds. This time it's not worked out perfectly.
24.
They weren't that well placed, actually. Maybe something pops to one of the bottom pockets here. If he's taking that one to the green pocket, top right, that's not an easy angle. He's definitely playing it. Might be screwing the cue ball around of two cushions here. They've missed the pot, unfortunately.
Danger.
Worth the risk.
24.
Left something to the left middle, though.
1.
Start of a show that these two are both really fluent players. Stuart's always been a player that gets on with the game. Attractive to watch him play.
8.
Bingham loves to travel, loves to compete, but he did tell me backstage that he has a bit of trouble with jet lag.
9.
Recently back from China, and he said he was wide awake at 4 o'clock this morning. Still hasn't got the old body clock on the right pattern.
Oh, he's certainly not frightened to travel around, though, jet lag or not, because he is, well, the stereotypical will play anywhere, FQ will travel all around the world. He'll go to play snooker. He absolutely loves the game. There are players like that. Mark Selby's another one, loves to play 50. In all the tournaments. Sean Murphy. Some players are fairly reluctant on occasions, but he 16. Just loves playing. Overhit that, played for the blue to go into the bunch of reds, but that's, well, it's a bit thin, that shot. He might still have it, but it's more of a missable shot, though, from that angle. Played it very nicely indeed. Deserves to be on one.
21.
Well, he's not on the one that he'd like to play, to the left corner. He's on the one below it.
22.
I think this is the kind of match we can expect, these two playing shots from the start, giving chances away but scoring.
29. 30.
Just picking up the pace of the table. He's top side this time.
35. 36.
No, he's not played that one perfectly. The stun run through. Maybe just got a little bit low on the cue ball. He didn't come through far enough. He's on the black, but he didn't want to be playing with the rest.
43 44.
Now, it's not too bad if he finishes just straight on this red. He hasn't got an angle on the blue, but just be looking to screw back just a couple of inches here. That's it. And just standing in on the pink, keeping the game simple, making the pot easier.
49.
He nearly missed one of these early on in the break. Went into the right-hand side of the pocket, the last one.
50.
Screwed. That stun run through onto the black. Closing in on winning the first frame here. 50. I've seen these swallowed up along the cushion in
57.
Previous weeks of the Premier League. He plays it slowly, should be okay.
58.
58. Ding played the red up into the top right pocket, thinking maybe it was a shot to nothing, but there was a red potable, and this is the upshot.
65.
So Ding's had a lot of sitting down time to think about what he did.
Bingham needs just this red and a colour to secure the opening frame.
66.
Yeah, really good start, as he did in the match with Sean Murphy. Yeah, it's a big surprise that he didn't actually win that. 3-0 up and a long way in front in the fourth frame. And he started off tremendously well here again.
71.
Well, I think the green is the natural up in behind the red, a right-handed red down the cushion.
And he's overscrewed it by a long way. Can't believe he's finished there.
75. Very responsive cloth. I think that's probably why he overdid it.
Stuart Bingham, 75 in the front.
But with that break of 75, Stuart Bingham leads Ding Zhen Hui by a frame to nil.
A very confident start from Stuart. His one chance that he got was all he wanted there to take the frame comfortably. Give a notice there of what he's playing like. Oh dear, oh dear. That was a strange one because I don't think he played the pot. If he had played the pot, played it thinner, one thing the cue ball wouldn't have done would have been to go anywhere near the pack. So neither one shot or the other there. Got away with it though. It was a very dangerous shot that Ding had played.
Bingham chose a safety, which was when he developed the black from the two reds, but he's sent it from one safe position to another.
This looks a difficult one, Clive. Could be a time extension job, this. Running low on seconds, and what shot is the one he's going to play? Wow. Deciding that he's got enough time to play it, but he's got to be careful. No easy route back to bulk here. They pass all the reds, but the blue's another obstacle in the way.
Didn't intend to cannon the second red.
Wonder how confident he is. This was the shot. Tried to miss that red, as Clive pointed out. Don't see him taking on a pot here. I think he'd play off the yellow for safety. Maybe the brown, but Bramble. Whatever he's playing, it'll be over on that same place in the table that he got Ding last time. Not played it all that well. Both players have looked at a couple of reds, see if there's a plant on, but there isn't one because another red is in the way. So it would be very handy if there was something like that, combination of some kind on right now, because every safety shot looks to be awkward. There you see, two reds there, not quite lined up. Well, that shot was as much about the cue ball as anything else.
Well, he was reckoning that if he didn't pot the red, he was going to be very unlucky to leave it.
It's an awkward safety shot, whichever way you look at it. The way the pack are, they're all out in the open. He's probably going to have to play thin off that red. It's a sliver of the red he wants to hit. Can't take a risk and hit it too thick like that.
Foul.
That was the problem. It wasn't easy, or as easy as it seemed. That safety shot, had to catch it really thin. I think Ding is trying to play a little shot to nothing. We should take the cue ball up the table whether the red goes in or not.
Didn't threaten the pocket, didn't get the cue ball back to bulk as he intended.
A little bit of scrappy safety at the moment. Last two shots Bingham has played have not been very good. In the jaws of the middle pocket there. Now this looks like trouble to me. I suspect this is going to take a bit of working out. Doesn't seem to be a plant available. Might be looking at an extension here to try and give himself more thinking time.
Time extension.
Each player is entitled to claim two time extensions of 25 seconds in each frame.
Yeah, this is horrible. It's the old expression, there's only one shot here. I don't know what it is. It's one of those. And he can use another extension.
Time extension.
But that means he's vulnerable at the end of a frame. He's used them both now on this one shot. Hope he knows that later on he can't use another one in this frame anyway. I think that he should have thought of a shot before then, if he could, to save one for later.
Left the cue ball down in the left-hand corner, knowing that he was going to leave a potable red, but the cue ball would be cannoning into other reds by the look of it. Not worth attempting the pot.
No, but it'd be interesting if Ding could get Stewart into a lot of trouble again. He'd have to play without any extensions. You have to think very quickly.
One.
That is not bad for the blue. Not bad at all. Angle takes him down towards the reds.
Six. Seven. Thirteen. 40.
Won't be straightforward to win the frame on the blue and pink without the black available, but it is possible.
Holding the pink spot so that he could get rid of this red.
21.
Oh, agonising wait to see whether he can get to this or not. I think he can only just do it. He's a bit lucky there. The millimetre, I think he'd have been behind the red. But it's a complicated break.
27 28.
This is the last of the easy reds coming up when this pink is potted.
By choosing the right reds,
34.
Bingham has made the pink potable to both corners and both middles.
35.
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't play on the pink in the middle there. He's the kind of angle he's got on the pink now is taking him away from the reds. So this is a A risky shot that he's trying. This has got to go in. Tremendous shot. I think that was almost one of them instances where you knew he didn't have much time to think about that shot. Not quite sure how it dropped, though.
Yes, it was well onto the jaw. But a new cloth. And they do slide in
41.
More if there's a new cloth rather than one that's been worn in a bit.
Now this is a bit weak in pace there, but there is a red in the middle. Those two reds that he's closest to have been there all the
46.
Way through, and a bit of a nuisance. I wonder if one of them can be potted with right hand side from there. The fact that he's right behind this helps him. He didn't have a clue where the cue ball was going to finish 47. There. And that's what happens when you lose control. You hit the wrong red first. That was the problem with the shot. Hit the other red first and the cue ball went haywire.
Yellow ball.
Yeah.
Foul and a miss.
It'll be called a miss.
Bingham 47. Things
tonight, Brendan Moore, who's making his Premier League debut in front of the Sky cameras.
Yes, that's because Paul Collier, the regular referee, is refereeing a Players Tour Championship tournament in Gdynia, Poland, tomorrow, Saturday and Sunday. Yep.
Good shot. The reason I say that is because it's one of those snookers where you can give away 16 points or more, 20 points, trying to hit that yellow, sliding past it was always very possible.
Much more emphasis on the safety than the pot, but that's not safe.
One.
Well, I know that Ding Junhui was favourite for this match. Anyone that's shovelled their money on him might be a bit concerned now, because it looks like he's going to go a couple of frames down here. He's going to have to win all the four frames remaining to win this match, which is not going to be easy.
Five.
So 50 points in it once the blue is potted. Red in any colour, and it is 2-0. Be the red with the rest now instead of the one that he played on. This is very good stuff from Stuart.
11. Eight.
Well past the winning post now. A 75 break gave Bingham the opening frame.
24.
He went into the lead with one of 47 in this.
25. Stuart Bingham, 31 and a frick.
Only 23 minutes play has been required for Stuart Bingham to lead Ding Junhui by 2-0.
table time, Ding. He got in first with a great chance, didn't make all that many off it. Since then, it's been a something of a struggle. He's had to watch Stuart Bingham, who looks in very fluent form to me. I thought he was going to make a breakthrough many years ago, Stuart. Year 2000, when he beat Stephen Hendry, who was defending world champion. It's taken him a while.
A thin safety return to Bourke was the idea there, but he missed his intended red altogether.
Yeah, that's the only part of his game tonight that hasn't been very good. He's missed a few safety shots.
One.
Well, I said in the first frame this is how he likes them, but the break ended at 24. And
eight.
This is another good chance. Looked sharp when I watched him practice earlier, but again, I guess they all look like that now, don't they? Hit the ball beautifully and don't miss when they're practicing.
He plays that shot especially well. Blue.
14.
Inches bunch and a full ball cannon on the pink. Cue ball hardly moved on impact with the pink.
Yeah, excellent shot, Clive. I agree. It was the pink wasn't close to the red, so he had to hit it full on. It was a beautiful shot. He is one of the best at breaking the pack in the game, I always think. Just a bit awkward to get the rest down for this shot. He's trying to get it so that he doesn't foul that red, which he's managed to avoid.
20.
They just feel that if he's going to play any part in this match, he needs to score heavily right now. Yeah, good time to start, as soon as frame three has got underway.
23.
He was worried about snooking himself. That's why he hit it a bit more firmly, so that he could just nudge it out of the way, that red, which he's done. So it's a good shot.
30.
Oh, there's a couple of reds that pop to the same pocket as the black that he's taking, so he should be screwing over to the left of the pack. That's it.
38.
Ding is the only player that just puts his chalk on the side of the table of all the top players. You see
39.
That in the snooker club, people doing that. It used to drive me mad. Used to throw it on the floor. Most players put it in their trouser pocket or whatever.
46.
I do remember Dennis Taylor relatively early in his career showing up in a beautiful new green velvet suit, and the only problem was as soon as he went to chalk his cue he realised he hadn't got any pockets in it.
Came in handy later on at the bar, I suppose, not carrying any money around either.
54.
And that could be the end of the break unless he plays the double here. Depends how he's feeling about this. Double's on.
Ding Junhui, 54.
Useful but not conclusive.
Now this could be a double as well. Both players have missed them.
And that was meant to be a shot to nothing, but he stuck the red. A little rueful smile from Stewart makes me think that he's left this on. You get very little emotion from Ding. But this is a good chance for 2-1. Match is going along pretty rapidly at the moment, isn't it? Which is no surprise. Such a difficult player to work out now, Ding. I thought he was going to be, you know, the next really big thing. And of course, he's won a number of big tournaments. He's twice a UK champion, so he's pretty much a long way there. But he's become quite inconsistent, I always think. Never really know how he's going to play. I know one thing, at his best, he can be quite brilliant.
Four.
I don't see why he should be inconsistent. He's got a technically very sound game. He's very happy and settled in his personal life with his girlfriend, Apple.
That is not a good shot. He still needs a red in the colour. 75 points available. He's 64 in front. The red down the cushion would be extremely difficult. I don't even think he can get to it. I think he's angled on it. Don't think he played the plant, but he knows that he's not quite done enough to win the frame yet.
Still needs a red and a colour, in fact.
Now Stewart won't mind getting this red into play, but could do with making this a good shot. Yeah, he plays a very open game, and he either pots them or his opponent does. He's one of those players. Don't get me wrong, there's more to him, but he does like to take his shots on. He's always played like that.
This is where Ding secures the frame.
Four.
So that's one snooker needed. Needs to pot this to give himself extra insurance.
Eight. Nine.
The rest of this frame, academic now.
16. 17. 24 25.
May be able to cannon the red into a better position.
31.
Yeah, not been playing quite 10 minutes in this frame, and well and truly dings.
32.
I suspect he'll be thinking very much about the next frame now. Not be too worried what he pots and what he doesn't from now on in.
38.
The intricate positional shot fails.
Deng Junhui, 38 in the frame.
But with breaks of 54 and 38, Deng Junhui takes it the third frame without Stuart Bingham scoring. Bingham still leads, though, by 2 frames to 1.
Stuart would like to get to 3 frames, obviously, to just guarantee get something out of this match the way he started, like a train. But, would hope to get something from this match from here. Of course, he led 3-0, as we were saying earlier, in his first match. That was a way off, but rolling it like that is always a possibility. And the only way he probably felt he could leave was the one that he was playing. I don't think he's left anything else. Stuart could possibly go for this red and screw back, leaving the cue ball where it is now. And he'll leave nothing for Ding, and if the red goes in, he's on the black. That's what he tried.
Yes, just enough room to get behind it and play the back heel, leaving the cue ball tight on the rail.
Yeah, not easy to get out of this. I mean, a bit of thinking time might be required here. He's deciding it's worth just playing the shot. Seconds are ticking down. It's always a worry, the double kiss on that shot. You never know the red and the cue ball are going to come back next to each other.
He's happy enough with how it's turned out, though.
I was saying earlier on, I think that winning that tournament in Australia in 2011, his first ranking win, gave Stuart a lot of confidence, a lot of belief, and he's played pretty well since then. He just looks more dangerous now as a player, I think.
Yes, I was there. He was 3 down with 4 to play against Mark Williams, but came through to win.
One of them frames where we get the cue ball safe at this end of the table, the black end. All the reds end up, just about all of them, at the other end of the table. You never quite know how these situations start, but no player can play a safety shot and leave the cue ball at the bulk end with all the reds down there. So it's screwing back to the black end. Happens every now and then, this sort of thing. There was a worry when that red drifts down the table, but he's not left it on. A little bit lucky. Well, he's just going to be able to drop into these, I'd say. Of course, in the Sky Shootout, which is played in the end of January every year, he wouldn't be able to play that shot. No cushions have been struck, but those are not the rules in the Premier League.
Funny enough, they are the rules in the American version of the game, in the official rule book.
Yeah, I think
players got very switched on to playing in the shootout over the last couple of years. Tremendous event. We all look forward to that. Playing and commentating on it. It's tremendous. Great fun.
This safety duel is coming up to the 6 minute mark.
The other thing that usually happens is when the Reds go at the other end of the table, when the chance comes, it's usually a really good one. The player has so many Reds to choose from.
There's no friendly cluster to roll into now.
Interesting to see what he plays here. What's he done here? He's underhit it. That was a risk. I didn't see him walk down the other end of the table to have a look at that. He obviously tried to get to the cushion because the two Reds are covered to the top right. But he's left a chance. Yeah, I think... I don't think Ding had anything easy there, but that was a risky shot selection that he played. How about this for a chance to go 3-1 up? Couldn't put the balls any better.
8.
And he ran the black end, but if he does lose position, they have to go up to the bulk end. They're all
9.
Lined up along there as well.
Just rolling 16. It across the nap. He put the red onto the far jaw. I didn't expect him to miss that.
No, I think the point you made across the nap is very truthful. There's not a lot of nap on these, I admit, but he always, as a player, would slightly worry about hitting those slowly. And
1.
He should have made a lot more than that.
Could well be the pivotal point of this frame.
6.
A couple of minutes 7. Ago. It was a great chance for Bingham to go 3-1. Now, it's an equally good chance for Ding to go 2-all.
Oh, just a little flick of that red. Didn't want to push it near a cushion, so didn't use any pace on it.
19. 20.
That's another good shot. It's pushing the red out of the way. Seed the shot very quickly. Both these two players are not really affected by 25 seconds per shot, only on the odd very difficult shot, but in general
26.
They're well inside that. They've always have been quick players.
27.
Yes, the 25 seconds time limit is an issue usually when it's not obvious what the player should do. 30. Players with this quality in break building situations
32.
Know the patterns. I've played to them for years. So 25 seconds is absolutely fine.
33.
He'll be thinking about taking lower value colours, I think, with his reds from now on in, because getting from the black up to the reds will be more difficult. This is not a good shot. That's no good at all.
40.
Dicey cut to right corner.
Yeah, cue ball just drifting up the table. Could finish anywhere. The pot's all he can worry about here. Got it. That's not worked out too badly. I had no clue where the cue ball would finish. Looks like the danger is over for the time being. He's back in.
46. 47.
Well, snookered on his intended red.
52.
I was going to say, once I hope this one goes, I think it must do. It's actually a good red to get out of the way. Probably better than the one that he played on.
53.
Didn't mean to cannon the brown like that.
58.
Looks like the red in front of the yellow as it stands, just behind it there, into the right middle, is the one he'll play. This is a difficult one to keep the break going. And it's very good.
59.
A much better shot than it first looked at. To play that difficult angle slowly made it look like it was easy. 1 more red and the frame is his. Got a real game on our hands here. It's been good. Enjoyed this.
64.
So Bingham didn't convert his frame-winning chance early in the frame.
67.
Ding, despite one or two difficulties, has done so.
68.
It's been a bit around the houses this break, hasn't it? He started off in good position, but he's gone out of it two or three times, but he's recovered. And as you say, Stuart will be thinking about that chance he missed. A lot of sitting down time for him
73.
This time around. It was all Ding earlier on, sitting down listening and thinking about what had gone wrong.
Well, Ding almost kept alive his chances at the century and a £1,000 bonus. But he's happy enough with 73. It brings him level at 2-2.
Yeah, looking at that, it's very difficult at this point to say he's going to do what. You wouldn't think that Sean Murphy would have a great chance, and in the other group, Stephen Lee's lost both his matches. He's got, I suppose, a chance to win them both, but it's everything to play for. That's another similar shot to the one before. I'll tell you, he is struggling with his safety shots. That's 3 or 4 on that side of the table. Thin cuts he's got all wrong. And he's presented a marvellous opening chance again for Ding. Can't fault his potting and scoring, but his safety's not been up to much at all. It probably doesn't play as big a part in the game as it used to, but you know, the game has never changed. You have to have a safety game. Stewart's got one, but tonight is not there at all.
Well, 74% of Bingham's safeties have prevented Ding from potting a ball. Exactly the same percentage as Ding.
Thank you.
Yeah, but eight. I would also add to that that Ding hasn't really ever got him in a load of trouble, but somehow Ding has got in like he did this frame. He wasn't really in a lot of trouble with Stewart, but the safety shot went wrong. Oh dear, hit across that one horribly. The worst shot he's hit for a long time.
Well, it's almost worth a note in the diary. October the 4th. Ding missed a straightforward black from its spot with his hand on the table.
Yeah, that's not his game. Tell you what, Stewart was out of his chair quickly. Never saw that he'd be back to the table so soon.
Cross double combined with the safety.
Well, the option to roll behind Bock colour, but I don't think he'll take it. It's a good shot. It was a very thin cross double. Sort of shot, if he'd have missed it, he left it. I think that's where the game has changed. That shot he just put it there. Didn't have his hand on the table, it was on the cushion rail.
Four.
I'm sure that years ago more players than now would have rolled in behind that.
Five.
Yeah, we sometimes talk about playing the percentages, but the percentages have actually changed because everybody pots so well these days.
Oh, absolutely. You can only take on what you think you're going to get, but as you rightly say, players now pop more balls. They're looking to be more attacking. Look at that, 97% for Ding. That's a very, very high pot success, despite just missing a black off the spot a few moments ago. It tells you that he didn't do a lot wrong in losing the first two frames either. This is tight. You might have to just use a touch of right-hand side on this to straighten the angle. Make sure that you can see enough of the red.
Feng Junhui, 12.
Couldn't straighten it quite enough.
Let's give it a chance back.
One.
Now this is the key shot, I would say. There's a red at the bottom of the pack which pots to the left corner. The red below the black is also pottable. Anywhere below the pink on the right of the table, it should be absolutely fine. That's all right.
Five. Six.
Slightly nearer the side cushion than he intended.
Coming down on this difficult shot. Played well enough.
There's
the overhead of this shot. I wonder if he can get to the red at the bottom of the pack. I think he might just be able to. It's a bit like the shot that Ding had. He might have to straighten the angle up on this. He had a quick look at the clock. He knows that the seconds are ticking down. Might be a shot to take more time on. Got an extension if he wants it. Well done.
14.
Despite the beeps starting on his final backswing.
Twenty.
I can't believe that went in. Didn't look anywhere near. Look at this. Oh, you're kidding. How did that drop? 19. That does surprise me, that went in.
No spot for the pink, so it's going at the bottom of the bunch in a direct line between its spot.
Thanks.
And
26.
The black spot.
27.
Crucial shot once again. Doesn't want to go into the pink full on. That would not necessarily leave him on a red. Not bad, but still not an easy next red that he's got.
34.
Well, this is a difficult little shot. Cut back red to the left corner.
35.
Looks good for Bingham now, though. Because that tricky red has also opened that cluster. 42. Judge Cannon.
42.
Golden chance to go 3-2 up and thus assure himself of at least a point.
49.
With one frame to play.
50.
Yeah, 56. Red and the black will be enough. It'll be 44 the difference, 43 on.
57. 64.
One snooker needed already. This red would give Bingham all the extra insurance he would need.
65.
And now the century is a possibility.
1,000 pounds a frame and £1,000 per century.
69. 70.
It would be Bingham's 174th century in professional competition, but I think the way that tournaments have proliferated in the last couple of seasons, the total of career centuries is becoming
75
more and more irrelevant, because there are so many tournaments that all previous records for career centuries have been obliterated. But anyway, no century there. 75 did the job. Stuart Bingham goes 3-2 up with one frame to play.
Well, that's one of his better safety shots tonight. Cut off the right-hand side of the table. The pink's covering the red so he could play thin from that side. Put Ding in some trouble. It's a much wanted. Now, saying, can he just get to something on that side of the table? Must be just a coat of paint sticking out. Oh, he's got there. Didn't have any control over it, though. Difficult shot to miss the blue on that one that Ding played. It's one of those shots, you know it's on. It's almost unavoidable to get away from the blue ball. That angle he comes across the table at. Well, he played the little cannon, I think, on the red. Would have taken him right behind the black. Pink to the middle would have a lot of risk attached because I don't see how he could finish on a red. Low percentage. So I think the right shot here to keep the pressure on. Cue ball again over on the left of the table he wants here.
Stuart Bingham won.
Even more troublesome than the previous one, I think. Stuart knows the importance of this frame, especially after throwing away a 3-0 lead the first week that he played and getting a point instead of two. No idea what he played.
Stuart Bingham, four.
What could he have played? Must have played dead weight, thin, off that red up the table. It's a very odd shot that he's trying here. Got to be very trusting in any table in the world to play this shot. He's playing a chip this red, thin, dead weight. That's what he tried the first time. He's trying something else. I think that's wise.
If Bingham could win this frame, he would have 3 points from two matches. It would leave Ding on 2 points from two matches. Bingham thought he could attempt that plant without much risk.
Yeah, it looked on, didn't it, looking at that. I think, well, I know, looking at that, he's definitely left a red on to the middle. He's left one in the same pocket. So, as it turned out, Bingham's shot was with risk attached.
Eight. Nine. 15.
Sixty. Yeah, just a little bit straight on this. Mm, 250 points each. And a chance the match could finish three apiece as well with this chance he's got.
24.
Two reds above the black are just in his way a little bit. He'd like to somehow get those out of arm's way, and it would mean that things would be easy at the moment. You just feel there's a little bit of a complicated break he's trying to make here. Screwing onto that red. Straight on it, then he doesn't really have an angle to get out onto the black.
31.
Without having to play from the cushion rail. and it is fairly straight. And you see it, he just cannot get the cue ball away out to the right for his next shot.
Time
worth
extension.
Extra time, isn't it? The extension added to the 5 seconds or so he had left. 25 seconds are the extension times. To a frame, you're allowed. I think it was a good time to take one.
32.
Intended to stop the cue ball short of the balk line, but he was just that little bit uncertain about the pot, and in making sure of it, he allowed the cue ball to run on further than he would have liked. Still, it's worked out okay.
34.
Well, that wasn't one of his best. He nearly missed the yellow, and because he never got it into the middle of the pocket, the cue ball didn't finish where he meant.
37.
The long look at a red to see if it passes another one. I think it does. Looking at that, he'd like to be right behind it. Now what's he looking at? I think he's going to have to play the one that he first looked at. It will go past the other red. There's always a chance he'll clatter into it on the way through, though, I suppose.
Like that.
Deng Junhui, 37.
Worse still, Ding has left a red on for Bingham, who comes to the table 32 behind.
Yeah, Ding didn't look very comfortable on that last shot.
1.
He's not finished any good for a colour.
1. Stuart Bingham, 1.
That was very well played. It would have been easy to get right up behind the brown from directly behind it, but at an angle, it required a much more difficult shot.
Foul and a miss. Stuart Bingham, 4.
He's got an awkward shot here. Okay. I think he's just trying to hit the left of that red as we look. That's the problem. If he hits it any other part of it, he might leave it on. This is not a nice shot to be having to play. Don't know if he can go two cushions around. Maybe that's what he's tried, but it's very difficult.
Stuart Bingham, 4.
Well, it could be that he's playing it around two cushions, but it looks extremely tight if he is. Maybe that's what he tried, but as you can see, he comes close to the pink and the red that way. I don't see how this shot's on that he's playing.
Foul.
Could be all day and all evening trying to do this. Playing it one cushion is not unnatural.
Okay, sure.
Two cushions is, but I think the red and the pink are in the way. Well, no progress there.
Foul and a miss. Stuart Bingham, 4.
So that's 16 away.
Yeah, it wasn't a replay we were showing you. It was exactly the same shot. Points are mounting up. I know why he's playing on that red. The first thing you look at when you're in a snooker is the one red near a cushion is the one you want to try and lay on. But it's not a natural. in the end, he just might launch the cue ball at all of the reds and hope for the best. That's what you call plan B. Hope the referee can't replace them if he hit the colour first. Oh. It's not on, you know, that two shot, the two cushion shot. It's just not on.
Stuart Bingham, four.
I think it's time for the charge of the Light Brigade. Just whack it. Hit and hope.
As a cricket fan, Neil, I thought you might say time for the long handle.
I think so, anything but what he's doing, which is not doing any favours at all. He's not getting very close to the red. If he does hit the red on the wrong side, he'll just leave it over the pocket. Play this a bit differently. Four away again.
Foul and a miss.
Now this time, Stuart, I wonder if Stuart might not have it put back. There's a red to the middle. This is a golden chance if it goes in. Well, he certainly did the right thing there by not having it back. I didn't like that shot, Bing, did he? It was horrible, the situation he was in. I'm not really criticising him, but the way he went, it just seemed that it was going to happen exactly how it did time and time again.
Nine.
So the snooker that Bingham laid behind the brown not only
16
gained him 20 penalty points, but what may well prove to be the match-winning 17. Opening.
It may do. The two reds below the pink, the left-hand red is the one he would like to play on. We'd open the other one up to the opposite corner pocket.
Time extension.
He's using his time extension. I think that's very wise. That's the red in the middle of the table there. That's the one he would love to play on. Good effort. Well, as it happens, he's got on the one in the middle. That's his
21.
Saving grace. It might mean that he can play on that red the next time. That's not bad. I don't rate that shot. It's wasn't meant to be with the rest, this shot on the yellow. It's an excellent recovery.
24.
By potting this red, he would make the one next to it available.
Yeah, he'll still want the red that's on the left cushion, though.
25.
But it could be. Yeah, it won't be the colour after it. So he'll be able to roll it in. This is going to be a good shot, though, round two cushions. Got to get the pace right. That is, what was it? Not an easy shot, made to look very simple.
32.
And to get the necessary angle, he deliberately played the black in off the far jaw.
33.
Yeah, this is what I'm saying. Now he'll be on the red, but he won't need a colour, so he can just drop the red down the cushion if he is able to. Playing to the scoreboard. Getting 2 points out of this match. 40. I don't see him forcing this in and playing out into the wide 40. Open spaces. He knows the score. He's had a quick glance up. Got to make sure of this.
41.
No heroics there.
That black dropping removes all vestige of doubt about the outcome.
48. Stuart Bingham, 50.
From 2-0, Stuart Bingham took the match 4-2 with decisive breaks of 75 and 50. After two matches, he has 3 points. Ding Junhui has 2.
Snooker Premier League already had one game tonight. It featured Stuart Bingham and the two times UK champion Ding Junhui. Ding was favourite for that, but on the table, Stuart produced the goods, winning 4 of the 6 frames to put him into second place in Group A. And Group B looks like this. As you can see, what a game we've got in store for you next. Judd Trump against Peter Ebdon. So let's meet the players, as always, introduced by MC, Mr. John McDonald. And first up, it is the 2002 world champion.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the action. It's coming to you live from the Guildhall, Southampton. Matchroom Sport proudly present the PartyPoker.com Snooker Premier League. Coming to you live here on Sky Sports HD. Well, it's 6 frames with a 25-second shot clock. Our referee is Brendan Moore. And now it's time to meet the players. It's time to meet the reigning China Open champion and the former champion of the world, Peter Ebdon!
Mr. Peter Ebdon, good to see you. Good to see you at the top of the table as well. This is your third game. When you look at a game like this, is it a must win or a mustn't lose?
Yeah, I think I need to win. I think we both need to win. You know, it's pretty much up in the air. So, yeah, look forward to it and hopefully I can register a positive win tonight.
Okay, now I don't want to stir anything, but people are talking about it backstage, so I thought I'd mention it to you, that when you played Ding this season in the Australian Open, you were relatively slowish. You won 5-4, but Judd criticised you on a social networking site for your play. Does that bother you?
No, I actually had my contact lenses in the wrong eyes that day, so unfortunately it took me a bit longer to sight the ball than usual.
I know we've got a shot clock here, you've got 25 seconds per shot. Can you go into a game like this knowing that you've got a limit on each shot with some kind of system in place?
I think you just got to take it as it comes and you know, just try your best. You know, sometimes, especially on the safety shots, it is difficult with the shot clock, but you know, we do have 2 time extensions per frame, so it's fair and the same for everybody, so just give it a best shot.
And finally, Judd's, you know, relatively new to the game of snooker. You've been in it for quite some time. When you come up against players like this, do you feel that there is maybe a point to prove?
No, not at all. I mean, you just take somebody like Judd as what he is, one of the very best players in the world, and you know, you've got to play really, really well against him. And, you know, I enjoy playing Judd as I do playing all the other top players. And I think when you play somebody in the top 8 especially, it makes you try even harder because you know you've got to play really, really well to win.
And finally, lenses, right way around?
I forgot to put them in, actually.
Good luck. Peter Ebdon, everyone. Thanks, Peter. Not easy for me to say right way round, but there you go. Peter's opponent is the brilliant Judd Trump.
Well, ladies
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to meet the reigning UK champion, the world number two, the amazing Judd Trump!
Judd Trump, I remember having a chat with you in week one of this season's Premier League, and you said, I'm playing now and I don't play for about 4 weeks. Now that you've had the chance to sort of look back at what everyone's done, is it a disadvantage or an advantage having that big gap?
It's just nice to sit back, watch everyone else play, battle that out, and then just get back into it now. I'm playing a little bit more regular now, so just excited to play.
And you're coming up to a year of being UK champion. How is your game at the moment? How much does that improve you?
Not really.
But with the confidence that brings, does it not make you a much more a tougher opponent to beat?
I feel like now I'm getting back to my best. I've had a couple of months where I haven't played too great, but I just want to be back winning tournaments again.
Okay. And finally, I've heard a rumour that you're going to try and slow Peter down in tonight's game. Is that true?
Well, yeah, I've been practicing it.
Best of luck. Should be an absolute cracker. Judd Trump, everyone. I think this just could be an absolute corker. Remember, you can tweet me your questions and I'll ask the players after this match. Just send your tweet to @SkySnooker. Right, let's rejoin our boys in the box. Neil Foles, and first up, the wonderful Clive Everton.
On their respective reputations, frame. This Good could be frame. Billed as tortoise v hare. But in fact, Peter Ebdon has adapted much better than most people thought he would to 25 seconds time limit. He's won one match, lost another 4-2, he's made a couple of centuries. He's coped with the restriction as well as most.
I think he surprised a few people the first week with his win and how quickly he managed it. Thought maybe at the end of his last match, when the pressure came on against Mark Allen, he wanted to take a bit longer on shots than he could. But this is a tough one for him. This really is playing Judd Trump, who is an absolute natural. Didn't play that, though, as good as he is. Well, this has to be a fluke. Well, it was a fluke. He hit another red on the way through, but didn't put his hand up to apologise. Just got on with it.
And he also finished at a fairly friendly angle.
Five.
On the brown.
Six.
That's not the right side of the blue, but the pink's on. So it was a red that he didn't mean to pot at the start of this little break, as far as it's gone. You have to take all of those. Most players will just put a hand of apology up, even though they probably don't mean it. It's kind of just the etiquette of it all, really, isn't it?
Thanks. 12.
Pink at the back of the bunch and not on its spot.
13.
Because there's no room for it.
Now again, he'd be looking, if he could, to play on the red just above and to the left of the black. But he couldn't do it on that shot, clearly. See, the problem is, now the red's on, where's his colour going to come from?
18.
Maybe able to screw back for blue off a second red.
It's going to take a lot of cue power, this shot.
19.
Had an angle not to split them up too much. But this break is doomed unless he can get that red by the black into play. Can he play safe?
Judd Trump, 24.
24 off an initial fluke. Well,
foul and a miss.
Ebden's done what Stuart Bingham was doing in the first match this evening. He's failed to make contact on a thin safety. Trump chose a safety which was bringing the black into play. What happens when you leave Trump on the balk line instead of the balk cushion?
Yeah, it's what they call leaving a player with his hand on the table. And that's where Trump is absolutely deadly. And he was just saying that in the interview with Andy Goldstein, that he feels that
six.
Maybe his game's coming together. And of course it did about this time last season as well, in time for that UK Championship, which is in a few weeks still. Start of December. Players can't play well all year round, and the game is almost a 12 months per year sport now.
There's a limit to how much competition a player's mind will stand, so
30.
It's quite an art to pick and choose their events. Trump missed the Australian 14. Open, for example. But he did play in the Shanghai Masters a couple of weeks ago, got to the final, and what a wonderful final it was. Lost 10-9 to John Higgins after leading 7-2.
Got hold of that one. He didn't mean to screw back anything like as much as that. Is he going for this? Oh, this is tough. Oh dear. Good. You're unlucky.
19.
To get that close and still miss. That reminded me of one or two of Jim Furyk's putts in the Ryder Cup the other night at the crucial stage that just went all round the hole.
One.
Trump went boldly for that tricky red to middle.
Six.
But having missed it, it gives Ebden a chance for a counter-attack.
Seven.
Yeah, it's a half decent opportunity. I don't think the two reds are that easy that are on the black spot. That's the worry. Might be that the right hand one of the two will pot. That would clear the table a bit. I'm not sure about from 12. There whether they're on. I think he has to play something else. Oh, there they are. If he'd have finished higher up the table, the top red, or the right-hand red as we look, would have gone easily. It may still go. Could be just enough sticking out. And he's done well.
13.
Well, this is turning into a good chance now. The red shifted away from the black spot. And that's the one he's on. That's a good one to remove also.
18.
Ebden gets stick sometimes for being 19. Methodical, but you can't argue that in the last 6 months his form has been right up there with some of the better players in the world. He won in China, he reached the final in Australia as well.
Yes, won the China Open last April.
26.
Got to the final of the Australian Open in the summer, well, our summer at least.
27.
Lost to Barry Hawkins, thus providing him with his maiden world ranking title. But I agree, Neil. He's in pretty good nick generally. He develops a red into a better position, but he doesn't want to finish straight on the one along the cushion.
34.
Yeah, and I think he is almost straight on it. Yeah, I mean, what can you do with this? How do you get the cue ball out? Maybe that he might try and run it through and just wriggle the cue ball in the jaws to bring it out to the middle of the table. That's something he might try.
Oh. 35.
Well, the trick shots usually come at the end of the evening, but that was a valuable one.
He did try that shot, didn't he, to wriggle it?
Yellow.
Well, he's not going for the black to play on the red up by the pink. He's playing to keep things tight. I think I can think of players that would have tried that. But you could never say that was a long shot. Very well played.
Yes, he played to his own percentages there, not anybody else's. Didn't feel 100% confident of the pot.
Didn't amount to anything, although he could be in behind the black here, Trump. I think he needs to be really tight on this, or he's played it terrible. Missed it altogether, the snooker. Bit of a fiddly shot, wasn't it? He was very close to the cue ball and object ball there, I suppose. I think of a good billiard player would have been right in behind the black there.
Meanwhile, Trump's left him tight in behind the pink.
Ebden certainly lost that little battle. Now he needs some luck. Do you want to hit half ball up the table off this to get the cue ball back? That's an excellent shot. That is a really good shot from Ebden.
Yes, it wasn't a matter of luck that he hit that red half ball. The pot not worth going for, even for Trump.
Well, Ebden's already kind of taken the sting out of the match at the start of it by not letting Trump in and let him dominate. If it gets a little bit tactical on the colours, you'd think that Ebden might have the edge. But, once again, Trump with his hand on the table, not saying he'll pop this, but he wouldn't lay long odds.
I think he believes those are easy.
Hit it beautifully. Tremendous shot. That's why he is such a good player. And, this is good enough as well. Nothing wrong with that shot. Again, you wouldn't want to be straight on this. And he's got a very, very slight angle, that's all.
Four.
Too slight to get out for black as he wanted to.
Yeah, I think if he gets a snooker behind the black, he'd like to cut the left-hand cushion out so that Ebden can't go that way. One cushion onto the ball. Well, he's played it.
Judd Trump, four.
To kill the black, and it's not a bad shot, I guess, under the circumstances. Obviously, Ebden as a right-hander. If he ever got down to the black, he would fancy potting it. I think that was probably a good shot there from Trump, just to try and put a ball a little awkward. 16-point advantage he's got.
Five.
was the two ways of looking at the shot that Trump had. He put the black safe. It seemed an intelligent shot, but if you got hard up behind the black, Ebden would have struggled to hit the yellow. So two different ways of playing the shot that he was faced with there.
Ebden tried to tuck in behind the green there.
Well, he's just got to think of a way keeping that man out for the next shot. Up and down the table, I think. Just to make sure he puts the yellow in a safe position. Sometimes it's just the only thing you can do is get the object ball safe.
Bothered about potting that. In fact, I don't think he attempted it because he couldn't get plumb on the green.
He definitely won't be able to get on the green from this, even if he pots it. Wouldn't surprise me if he refused this pot. Whether he went for it or not, to be honest. Maybe someone could tweet us and let us know. That was in between shots there. This time, awkward cueing for Ebden. You can only see the side of the cue ball.
Well, he took the chance to develop the black, but at the cost of leaving sitting yellow.
Still wants yellow, green and brown. Still got to play one more good shot here to finish across the table. Well, can't reach that very easily. Like to just lean across. It's a bit of a stretch. Maybe just reach it. My word, that's a stretch. Got to have something on the floor. Yeah, I think he was definitely overstretching there.
And now he's left the frame on for Ebden.
Can you believe it? Frame that he's been almost presented with here.
Three.
It was an awkward one. I think I can understand why Trump did lean over for that green, but I'm sure with an extension on his cue and a bit of a extra time, I think he would have got that.
Seven. 12.
Well, nothing to do with this, just knock it in with the black there. And this is a steal for Ebden.
18.
Played an important part in that frame. Peter Ebden has won it on the black to lead Judd Trump by the frame to nil.
certainly a lot of people that would have fancied Judd Trump to win this match. A few people said to me that they thought he was a good bet, and set them back a bit, hasn't it, in losing that frame in the way that he lost it, when he always looked like he would win it. I mean, the chance he presented with Ebden was a gift at the end, really. Stretching a little bit on the green that he played. Can't take liberties at this game. However good a player is.
Only one frame gone, but it's been enough to illustrate a difference of approach. Trump has gone for pretty well at everything. Ebden has refused a couple of potting opportunities in favour of safety.
Ooh, a little grimace from Ebden there, I noticed, because that man has put him in a lot of trouble, queuing right over the top of this green. It's a horrible shot. He's got to really get the cue up very elevated to try and get down and hit some of this cue ball. The red he's playing, he can see it full on. He's looking to screw the cue ball up and down the table. Hidden hope. In the end, I think he half panicked on that. It was a terrible shot.
I think his head came up on that quite dramatically.
It's a good job there's no shade on the table. Yeah, I think he'd have knocked it off the string.
Thanks. One.
And because his head came up, I don't think he hit the cue ball exactly where he intended to.
Apart from all that, it was all right, that shot. He was rushed into it, wasn't he? That was the problem. That's what the perils of the Seven. Shot clock can do to a player who's not naturally that quick around the table.
Eight.
I suppose Ebden can be thankful that it isn't a 20-second shot clock, as it experimentally was for the league last season. And Mark Williams remarked that only Ronnie O'Sullivan and Judd Trump could play to a 20-second shot clock as if it was normal.
Interesting that William should say that, because he is also a very quick player and no-nonsense approach to things. I think he's probably right, though.
10. The 11. Seventeen. 18.
He's always got that red up by the blue that he could take. If he hasn't got an angle on a colour, but I think he would like to play down the pink and black end of the table here. He's not played that very well. He's screwed it too much. He's on one, but it's awkward 20. With the rest, or maybe, again, a little bit of a stretch to get to that one.
20.
Well, it certainly wasn't as much of a stretch as the green that he missed in the last frame, and I was quite surprised that he missed that.
Yeah, he was more comfortable on that shot than the one in the previous frame, but he was just leaning across the table. Seems a bit straight. This could be a deep screw from Ebden.
One.
Well controlled.
7.
Ebden attributes his current good form, at least in part, to the vegan diet that he's adopted. He's always kept himself very
8.
Fit, but look at him now, there's not a spare ounce on him. None of those things necessarily help you to pot the balls, but Ebden's got a lot of ability as well. It may be fair to characterise him as
40.
The modern game's leading grinder, but that doesn't really do him justice. He's very skillful as well.
15.
Great tactical appreciation of the game.
It's true, but he's strange because he is at times a slow player. Everyone knows that. But in general, he is an attacking player still. I mean, he does have the tactical skill, obviously, and all the battling qualities, but he's an odd one because he's a slow player that does take shots on. Most slow players I can remember are all
21.
Pretty negative, but he's not like that. Unusual combination.
22. Peter Ebden, 22.
Bad miss.
Terrible. He's not even wobbled this.
One.
It could prove an important mistake.
7. Eight.
No guarantees that he'll go on and win the frame from here, because every one of the remaining reds after this one are a little bit awkward.
50.
Now, if he was finishing where he is now with that cue ball on that red that follows by the black, he would be okay on it.
8.
Choosing to play across the table. He's not gone far enough, though. This time, there's no stretching. He's got to get
21.
The extension on his cue. Where things start to get a little bit tricky.
8. Time extension.
He knows the importance of this shot. Strange thing is, he never used it. He had 31 seconds left when he played the shot in the end.
22.
Could just pop this pink and get onto the other red on the left corner. On the left cushion, that would be getting that difficult red out of the way.
28. Judd Trump, 28.
Would have been easier if the cue ball had been an inch or so further into the middle of the table.
9. And this is very troublesome indeed.
10.
If he's going straight onto the vault cushion first of all, that means he's in a lot of bother here. That is just not an easy way to escape. I think he's going to have to use another extension up here. There's no obvious shot.
Time extension.
Well, I don't think he's got any idea what to play. And he's only got 15 seconds to find a shot. hit and hope. Meyer, two reds, he finds his way back to vault. How lucky was that? Well, he's given Ebden something to go at, but this is there's pressure on it now.
Decent pot, but not on the black.
Peter Ebden, one.
Might just go a couple of cushions to try and get to this red. That's the trouble with that shot, isn't it? He's pushing it towards the pocket, and it just could be that he's left it on. Playing at the speed he played, I didn't understand what he could gain by that. Couldn't even pot it at that speed.
He needed to play that escape off two cushions. Much more chance of safety that way.
One.
Maybe he intended to and just didn't hit it right.
Well, this could be a kind of a repeat of the first frame, one that Trump dominated for the most part and ends up losing on the colours.
Five.
Just get the feeling this is where Ebden would like to dig Six. In and really take his time on these and give himself that 2-0 lead. But he knows he can't quite do that. He's got to get through these shots fairly quickly for him.
Well,
it's handy for Peter that the green is just a couple of centimetres away from its spot, because that means he's got a straighter angle on this. He hasn't got to go all around the table. Don't believe he's missed it.
Peter,
don't believe
Ebden,
it.
14.
Well, surely Ebden has thrown the frame away.
I mean, if you are going to miss that shot, it's going to be on the thick side, as he did, because he was trying to hold for the brown, but you can tell by his face there, he's mortified by what happened.
Three.
Trump has overscrewed from the green.
Can't imagine finishing anywhere worse than where he has. If he screws back any further, he's got an easy shot on the brown. This is tough now. Oh, that's an excellent shot. Great recovery. Still 18 points of difference, though. He's not safe. Ebden could get to a respot if he could clear blue, pink and black.
Tough shot that was.
Judd Trump, 7.
But the blue couldn't have run any safer.
Well, he's given Judd Trump something here.
Tough shot from distance.
Just cannot quite get over the line in this frame. It's a worry if you're a fan of Judd Trump that he just can't quite get that killer blow in. Now, Ebden pots this and he comes down towards the pink. And we could be looking at a reach spot here.
Five.
Well, he's going to have to go all round the table to get from pink to black. It's doable. He knows it. And just short of the left middle pocket here, with lots of side, can take him all round the angles. It's gone, hit the jaw.
Yeah, well, that's one way to get position.
I can't believe that.
Very fortunate positional shot from pink, but he spots the black away as well to tie the frame. An extra black will be required.
It's a tail. Your choice.
As usual, the player wins a toss, puts his man into bat. Will Ebden play the double here? It's not impossible. You can never tell with Ebden. He might play the long double into the top right pocket. He might try it. Well, he's not. He's gone for the negative shot. He's played it diabolical. We should have gone for the double now, Clive, doesn't he?
Well, anything but that. So Trump, to his immense relief, wins the second frame after all and levels the match at 1-1.
It was the more modern way of playing it that Ebden tried there, which was black on one cushion, right cushion, and the cue ball on the left cushion. But when it goes wrong, it looks really awful, like that shot did.
If you go back 20 years, the standard break off for a respot was to double the black back over the pink, blue and brown spots, but the modern shot is better if it's played well.
I'm trying to think who it was earlier in the season. Somebody cut one in a tournament. I think it might have been Barry Hawkins, actually. Went down to a re-spot in a match, and he cut one in from the spot, which you don't see that very often.
Not really recommended, because it's very much odds against.
Come awkward. Judd Trump has played a funny old match here. He looks pretty good at long range, but he dominated the first two frames. He's almost lucky to be 1-1. Well, this could be a big pocket here if he can't get to the red over the hole in the first place, that is. The one that's up the tail a bit might be a big pocket in off the other red or indirectly. I think he can just stick this one near the pocket in, though. That's what he's trying. Oh, it was a blur, wasn't it? The speed he hit that at. Didn't have a clue where the cue ball was going to finish, but it's all right.
Six. 7.
No. He didn't think there was any way the black went. Now all of a sudden, he's thinking it might. He was all ready to play something else. Will that go? And he thinks not. I think it might, but it's not a full pocket, that's for certain.
Time extension. Green ball.
Looks like he's going to have a go at this. It's green. Tried to force it there, didn't he? Tried to force the pace of the frame when that Trump, green and seven. At that speed was a low percentage shot, I think, even for Trump.
Yes, his willingness to take on shots like that is one of the reasons that he's become such an attraction, but the downside is if you miss them
one
and spread the reds, you're going to be sitting down for a while, more than likely.
Well, that's why he took so long to get out of qualifiers early on, because when he turned professional, trust me, he had a huge reputation as a player. But, you know, he got beat by players in qualifiers that played the percentage game a lot better but didn't have the talent that Trump's got. That
seven.
Took him a long while to get into the higher echelons of the game.
Eight.
A lot of force attached to that shot, but perfectly on the blue.
Thirteen. 14.
I'm sure when Trump took on that green, he thought he'd pot it. But it's not as if he's really in his stride at the moment. He's been involved in two very tight frames. Lost the first on the black. Won the second on a tiebreak black. So
90.
Maybe it wasn't the time to push the boat out even for him.
It looked a risky one. I mean, I suppose if he knocks it in, you'd say what a brilliant shot. But it did look like one that might be missed more times than he's got. And then you leave your man in here like Peter Ebdon, who you don't want to be doing that to, because he is so determined.
And apart from one simple pink in the last frame,
26,
he hasn't missed much.
Good idea to get the green out of the way, back on its own spot.
30.
Now, up to now, Ebdon has potted 95% of the balls that he's attempted. Trump's percentage is 85.
38.
Okay, some pots are easier than others, but Ebdon has been the more solid performer.
Which is not really a surprise, although I thought he might be just outgunned in this match. It's not really happened like that.
39.
Still going to be tough to win the frame from here. 32 points he's in front with this as well, but the reds are quite difficult. Wow. Develop the red and the black.
42.
What kind of angle does he have on this? I don't think it's a very big angle. He's playing this with pace. He could wriggle it.
Peter Ebden, 42.
Well, 10 out of 10 for prediction there, Neil.
I don't know what he played on, Clive. I mean, he's not even on the black from that shot. Strange way to play the shot, just pop the red and not be on anything.
Chance for Trump to knock two reds a little further from the cushion. He's trailing by 35. The more reds in the open, the better from his point of view. Very good pot from Ebden. On the retreat, one might say, but a single red, and if necessary a roll-up, is not the worst thing to do when you're in front as he is.
No, the roll-up's what he's playing. He's not queuing up as if he's interested in going for this in the middle pocket, and he's covered them up nicely. I just plan to lay on this.
Foul, the miss. Peter Ebden, 4.
Well, misjudged the angle, misjudged the strength.
One.
Well, this time, that same kind of shot along the cushion there, he's managed to get. Mm, 2-1 looks as if it's going to be in favour of Peter Ebden now, doesn't it? And lead of 48 points, two reds in the middle of the table who he'll concentrate on.
Nine.
So Trump needs 2 4-point snookers even in the unlikely
16.
Event of Ebden missing this red to middle.
Twenty-four. Thank you. 24 on the frame. Peter Ebden.
Ebden controlled that frame. He took it comfortably. He leads by 2 frames to 1.
It's a bit of a worry now for Judd Trump. How's he going to turn this match around? He's got to win three in a row to get all the points. I suppose he'd settle for a draw, wouldn't he, at this point? The way that he's playing. Giving chances away.
I'm sure he thought there that the red that he attempted was the only one he could leave.
Yeah, he's okay this time.
Time extension.
Hebden dropped his chalk there and had to pick it up, so he wasted a bit of time. He's using extension on this, which is not a very difficult shot. I suppose his problem is he doesn't want to leave that red. And in the right corner. Bit of a weak safety shot. He wants to be covering that red, otherwise he'd be very disappointed. That's not a good shot from Ebden, even to give Judd a sniff at this long red.
One.
Finished about as badly as it could have done, snookering himself on his intended red.
Yeah, there's some hope though. If he could pot this red and get on the pink, perhaps. It's, as you say, not what he played on at all. It's strange, isn't it? It was a shot that he played badly that worked out in his favour. That was a great recovery.
And was bound to split the bunch. Whether he potted the red or not.
Well, he was trying to hold it so they could get onto the red in the left middle, but he couldn't really do that. But he's still got another option, red to the corner pocket. Again, stretching. He's missed a couple when he's overreaching slightly. Not this time.
11.
He's got the ability to win frames in 6 minutes, 7 minutes, rattling through them. And that's what he would like to do now, get a couple of very quick frames under his belt, get to the front.
16 17. Twenty-four.
Things looking up now. Black will go to the left corner. Pink's very much available also. This is how he likes them. He's managed to
31.
Get the balls in open position from that one shot that kind of went wrong in the first place, where the reds will burst open. And if that's on the red, it's absolutely A1.
37. Thirty-eight. 45.
And that's also a very 46. Good shot. Well, the century's on. Probably not the first thing on his mind. It will be getting past the point where Peter Ebdon wants a snooker, but where the balls are now, you wouldn't bet against him making a 100 break.
53.
And thus earning a £1,000 bonus.
54.
Well, the pink will just sneak past the red.
60 61 68.
And very quickly, this frame is over.
I've been 69.
Playing long. Up to 7 minutes. That's all they've been playing. And this frame's gone. That's what I'm saying. Trump can do that to you.
76.
The break has only been in progress 6 minutes.
84. 85.
Nicely judged, Cannon.
91.
Ebdon just building himself up for the next frame.
Thanks. 92. 98.
It's been a very good break, this.
99.
And we are going to see a century.
104. 106.
Excellent positional play. Hasn't had to play a difficult pot.
109.
Judd's already made a 1-2-1 break earlier in the competition. Week one, actually. Up in Skegness.
130.
Beat it here, get to 131, which would be a candidate for the highest of the whole of the Premier League.
118. 124.
Superb. Top class.
Good frame.
A total clearance of 131 brings Judd Trump level at 2-2. Those with a match in hand.
Yeah, but also you would say that the winner of this match, if there was to be one, would be in a great position. Two wins from three for Ebdon, that would put him in a strong chance of finishing the front two in the group, and of course Trump would be 100% still.
And it is a fairly tough looking group as well. John Higgins back to form now, as we know, winning in Shanghai a couple of weeks ago. He's almost the player that won four world titles again after a quiet 2011.
One.
Full-blooded pot from Ebden, who has come through the bunch, which he might not have done.
Yellow ball.
It's a good job it went in. It was leaving a chance straight away. It was a good pot, though. Oh, dear. Oh, everything's moved there. Yellow, green, brown, blue all went.
Peter Ebden. One.
Careering around the table.
Yeah, the beeps may have put him off, and I don't think he had quite the presence of mind to ask for a time extension, but he's been lucky enough not to leave anything.
He's going to be more put off by the beeps than other players, isn't he, Ebden? Let's be honest, because he's a bit slower. He's not played all that slowly. Now, hang on a minute. Peter thinks he does it. Yeah, hang on a minute. Does he didn't
oh,
get
no.
Him, get him, is he playing that brown over the pocket? Don't think he is he? Because I know that he has... struggles with colour blindness. No. He's not done that. I saw him do it recently, actually, you know, in the final of the Australian Masters, which he lost to Barry Hawkins in the first frame. He hit the brown. There was a red on the brown spot, which confused him. The brown was away from its spot. And he just went into the brown because he suffered some colour blindness. For a second, I thought he was going to knock the brown in and try and clear up. Thankfully, that wasn't the case.
Well, I thought he might have been mistaking the brown for a red in this instance because the brown's in such an unusual place.
Yeah, it's the one of the few things you can ask a referee, actually, what colour is the ball in front of you. And, of course, he's allowed to tell you. As long as he knows, of course. Well, I think we're pretty safe in the knowledge that he knows it's the brown after that tremendous shot. This will go, but it's not a very nice shot to be playing. Queuing down on this as well.
Played it in such a way that he gave the red every chance to wriggle clear if it didn't go in.
This might be the kind of frame that Peter Ebden will be happy with, having just sat out a brilliant 1-3-1 break from Trump. Ebden, a little rueful smile there. Well, Trump was grinning anyway. Sure what for.
Time extension.
Well, he's taking a time extension here. He's thinking that this shot is awkward. Does he fancy the pot? Not really. He's got to make sure he doesn't go into the brown here. He's played it slowly. That's not a very good shot at all. In fact, it's a terrible shot. He's played a holding safety shot. He had a time extension, plenty of time to think, but he stuck Trump in.
One. 5. Six. Twelve. 30.
When Trump gets in round the pink and black like this, the reds in the middle of the table, the question that immediately springs to mind is this going to be a frame winning break?
Yeah, and as we're saying, it all happens so quickly.
20.
Doesn't take a lot of time on shots. He knows what he's doing.
21.
But it's been a tough old match for him. He's been out-thought and out-manoeuvred for a lot of it. But he looks to be in quite good form.
27.
Maybe just getting into it now. We just assume that someone like Trump will just come out and play his best from the very start, but he's settled into it in the last 15-20 minutes or so.
If Trump is going to be world champion and world number one, he's obviously going to have to win 30. All sorts of frames against all sorts of players. No substitute for experience, and the only way you can get it is on the match table.
35.
Yeah. He leapt up in the air as if he had a kick there.
42.
All he's done is stop the cue ball a little bit. It didn't look too bad. I'm sure he did get a kick if he says he did. Only a
time
small
extension.
One put a little bit of emphasis on the positional side of it and the fact that he was short with his thread, but he's all right. Took a time extension, which he's probably not going to take. Played the shot with
43.
Just under 30 seconds left. But all in all, he's getting into a position where he could take this 3-2 lead.
48, 49, 56. 57.
57. He's got chances of slipping behind those reds on the left here from the angle he's got on the black. Oh, he's gone right behind them. I think he's on one up into the yellow pocket there. That's not so bad.
64.
Not the one he wanted.
Frame ball.
Looking at other shots, but he's always going to play this.
65.
Sixty-eight in front, only 59 on.
69. 70.
Well, he's started to turn things on here.
76.
Can cannon the two reds near the side cushion into better positions.
77.
Yeah, not bad. He may have covered the pink with one of those reds, but it's maybe a chance to land on the other red, the safer of the two. And the shot? Well, it's strange, isn't it? He's kind of doing now to Ebden what people thought he might do from the very start. Trying to overwhelm 82. Him. Well, there's a little bit of an angle he's got here to get in behind the red.
Ninety in the frame. Judd Trump.
Judd Trump was 2-1 down, but with breaks of 131 and 90, he leads by 3-2 with only one frame to play.
Go at this already. Oh yes, that was the best shot of the match.
What?
That beautiful striking. Cube will just run and run there. He's got the red, of course, to the right
six.
Corner. Has he got another one? If he's on anything else, he's a little lucky. No, he's on that. I can assure you that is not the red he played onto, that gap. But he will take it.
No, he played on the two outer reds.
Seven.
Yeah, I think he recognises what a chance this is to win the match 4-2 from 2-1 down. At the moment the black's not on, but it's not to say that it won't be in a few shots.
No spot available for the pink.
30.
Oh, he's overscrewed it.
14.
Dear, oh dear. He's probably still got a shot, this yellow, but of all the places to finish, I mean, there's such a wide area. Didn't want to be there.
16.
He just keeps on potting balls. He's not necessarily
22.
Been in complete control in any of these breaks in the last 2.5 frames, but he just keeps on finding a way of keeping the break alive.
23.
Well, two reds pot the right corner. He would have wanted to be on the one just above the black, but he's
28.
Not got a very good angle on that one. And now it's not as good as it looks, this. They've got to smash the reds open here. That's a good shot, as long as he doesn't drop in there. He played it with a touch of right-hand side, reverse side off the cushion. which takes him right up the table. It was an excellent shot. And we're seeing what he's capable of. Just checking, I think, to see if any of those two reds by the black pot to the left corner. Love to be able to drop on one of those. Once again, reverse side on that. Left-hand side, taking the cue ball up the table. Not straightforward on the blue. But it's pretty devastating stuff, this. Can't say he's not finished on one. He got the worst kiss you can imagine on that red. And I think this break might be coming to an end, just when you thought that he couldn't miss. Judging by Trump's reaction, he's not on this red directly. Got to play safe, I'm afraid. Time to walk away.
Judge Trump, 47.
The red under the side cushion to minimise the chance of Ebden clearing up in one. If he does get in. Ball back into Bourke somehow or other. Hit the red much thinner than intended. Cannon the black. But they're still left a long red for Trump.
And if he goes far enough past Bourke, he'll play the yellow in the middle. Good pop this. No, he's decided to nip in behind it. That's
Judge Trump, one.
Suggests he wasn't perfectly on it, so that he couldn't get down for a red. And also, he knows, with a 48-point lead, Ebden's the one that's got to do all the running here. He can just sit back and wait to see what comes his way. Well, he's way off that.
Foul and a miss. Judge Trump, four. One.
Well, we've seen a really good burst of brilliance from Trump in the last 2.5 frames. He's been all over that man. He's not had a chance.
Ebden's a very good player, but Trump has the X factor.
Yeah, Ebden just potted one ball since he led 2 frames to 1. He's not quite over yet, but you just feel that he's on a roll. There's only the bit of a bad luck earlier on in the frame when he had a bad little nudge on a red. This is the reason why he didn't make another century break, I think.
7.
He was on such a roll that, in a way, you couldn't see anything stopping him, but he just drifted out of position. So he didn't win the frame in a single scoring visit.
30.
Nevertheless,
14.
He is still going to win it. He's already a long way past the winning post in terms of his opponent needing snookers.
20. 21.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to watch him play like this, isn't it, Trump? He is a brilliant player. Still a few rough edges, I'd say, with his game. Will he ever be anyone with such a polished game? But he's too good for Ebden tonight.
Keith Ebden for...
Josh Trump was 2-1 down, but with breaks of 131, 90, 47, and a concluding 27, he flew through the last three frames to win by 4-2. Two wins from two matches is Trump's record.
Yeah, wonderful night of snooker, confirmation of all our results. There's the one we've just seen, Judd Trump beating Peter Ebden by 4-2. That puts Judd top of the pile at the moment in Group B. And as we saw earlier on tonight, we started with Bingham winning by the same scoreline against Ding Junhui by the same scoreline. I'm glad to say that Judd Trump is with me now. Judd, great performance. How do you think you played?
I didn't play too bad. I played good at the end. But the first couple of frames I kind of give it to him, so it's a bit frustrating.
When you say give to him, you mean you weren't finding your rhythm early on?
I was just in control of the frames and I missed two pretty easy balls that I should have potted, so give him a good start, but in the end I played pretty well.
Is it difficult to settle in various conditions? I mean, we had a packed house here tonight, the lights are quite hot, a few of the players have mentioned.
Not really, I think we're all used to it now, by now. We've played on TV a lot, so it's the same for all the players. Peter played pretty well, I think, and I just didn't really miss towards the end.
You got a great break of 131 as well. As a snooker player, I mean, you're knocking in tons every day in practice. During a game, how much confidence does that give you?
It gives you a lot of confidence, but I don't really take any notice of how I play in practice. I just try and go out there and play my best, and it's nice when you've got a full house every week in the Premier League. It's nice to come and play in front of the fans and have a lot of support.
We saw Ding lose earlier on. A lot of people thought he might, and he still has got a chance of doing very well in this competition. A lot of people fancy you as well, not because you're playing so well at the moment, but also because of the formula involved in it, the shot clock, 25 seconds. You must fancy your chances.
Yeah, I fancy my chances. I don't think there's anyone in it this year that I can't beat. I've got a good start to the league, so hopefully now kick on and get to the semi-final. And just see where it goes.
Congratulations. Great night of snooker. Judd Trump, everyone.